Well, good morning, everyone. Morning. A very warm welcome to you on this Mothering Sunday morning, and a warm welcome to those watching from home as well. I was saying at Penmark at the earlier service, it feels a poignant Sunday for me, remembering that last year it was Mothering Sunday, which was our first service from my study because lockdown had just hit. They hadn't brought in the social distancing, and there was Rhiannon, myself and Gregor all gathered around my laptop trying to make Facebook Live work, and it not working and having to do it on Gregor's phone, and Gregor commando crawling on the floor of my study to try and get it all working. Happy but poignant memories. It feels that it's been a long year, and so it is great to be able to worship in church today, even though obviously we're distanced and can't have the numbers that we would have liked to have had here. But we're going to celebrate Mothering Sunday. I'm going to pray, and then we've got some opening words which will be up there on the screen, and you've got a sheet there, Graham, behind me. So, loving Heavenly Father, thank you so much for gathering us together on this Mothering Sunday. Help us to draw closer to you as we worship you. Teach us about your love, and help us to celebrate and rejoice, even though times are still very difficult. For we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Proclaim with me the Lord's greatness. Let us praise his name together. I will always thank the Lord. I will never stop praising him. Proclaim with me the Lord's greatness.
Let us praise his name together.
I prayed to the Lord and he answered me. He freed me from all my fears. Proclaim with me the Lord's greatness.
Let us praise his name together.
Find out for yourself how good the Lord is. Happy are those who find safety with him. Proclaim with me the Lord's greatness. Well, one of our all-age worship services in semi-lockdown would not be the same without a special guest, Mr. Wolf, and he has agreed to come along today. He was a little concerned when Conway and the network were going to be with us, but he's been amply provided for with dog biscuits in their absence. So that's brilliant. Let's welcome Mr. Wolf. Now, he is still in his bag this morning. So he doesn't need a lot of encouragement to come out, because he's told me he's very excited to be here today on Mothering Sunday. So I think he still needs a little bit of encouragement. That's it. Swap places so you can see firm. Brilliant. So I think we're not allowed to cheer. We're not allowed to shout still, but we are allowed to clap and we are allowed to stamp our feet. So after three, let's give Mr. Wolf a big welcome. One, two, three. Just checking out who's here. What's that? Has Graham been naughty? No, Graham's not been naughty. He's just very kindly sits over there so that everybody else can see the screen, which I think is very, very generous, don't you? Yeah, so do I. You've got me a present today. Oh, that's really sweet. But why have you got me a present, Mr. Wolf? Because you haven't got a mummy, but I look after you and take care of you. Oh, well, that's really sweet, Mr. Wolf, because that's kind of what Mothering Sunday is about. It's not just about mums, though it is about saying thank you to our mums. It's also about thanking all the people who care for us. It might be our mums, it might be our grandmas, it might be somebody else altogether. Am I going to get my present? Yeah. Well, where is it, Mr. Wolf? Over there. Okay, let me get it. Oh, you got me some flowers. But there's some magic as well. Wow, I like a bit of magic. Magic is rather cool. But you'll need some help. Okay, well, how can we help? You don't speak. No, we know that, Mr. Wolf. That's why you just whisper in my ear. But there's a magic word. Okay. Well, I think we can probably help with the magic wheel. And we've got extra help now because the Bellamy's have just arrived as well. So that's fantastic. Well, let them get in, shall we? And then they can help with the magic words too. Come on in. because Mr. Wolf has just given me some flowers for Mothering Sunday, even though I'm not his mum. I'm the one who looks after him, so he's given me some flowers, but there's some magic. And we've got a magic word to say. Well, actually, it's three magic words. Now, you've got to remind me what they are, Mr. Wolf. Okay, that's right. So we've got to say abracadiddy, abracadoggy, abracadoo. And then there's going to be some magic with the flowers. Is that right? Yeah. Think we can manage that? Yeah, now we're not allowed to shout it because of COVID, but we can say it quietly and effectively. Okay, so let's try it after three. One, two, three.
Abracadiddy, abracadoggy, abracadoo.
I can see that nothing's happened, Mr. Wolf. Do you think we need to try it again? Okay, let's try it again after three. One, two, three. Oh, something's happening. Oh. 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 I'm not sure that was meant to happen, Mr. Wolf. No. Well, maybe the magic isn't working. Well, do you know what? I think if we try it one more time, it might work. Let's try it one more time after three. One, two, three. Well, Mr. Wolf, they're amazing. But do you know what? I would have liked them even if they didn't work, because they were a present from you and because you were saying thank you. And that would have made them so special, even if they wouldn't have bloomed in these lovely colours. Well, I'm going to put them down. What's that? Don't eat them all at once. I'm not going to eat the flowers at all, Mr. Wolf. I know you can hear my tummy rumbling, but I'm getting my dinner made for me today, because that's what my daughter's doing for me. Get a nice present of a dinner. So I'm going to put these down. Let's put these down. And shall we say goodbye for now, Mr. Wolf? Because we've got some other things to do in our service today. Do you want to give him a wave goodbye, everyone? Oh yeah, he's off. He's off. He's off to go and have some sleep. That doesn't give the rest of you license to sleep during the sermon, okay? Now, before we get on to anything sermon-like, we've got a little quiz to do today. Now, underneath these nine cards, there are some pictures of animals and their young. And there's pairs of them. And the task is to find the pairs of the animals. And I'm not just going to let you choose willy-nilly, because there's some quiz questions to answer to give yourself a chance to pick some of the numbers. And because it's COVID, you'll just have to tell me the numbers and I'll turn them over, okay? And I hope you can see at the back. You'll have to get your super duper vision going so that you can see at the back. Okay, here's the first question. Mothering Sunday in the UK is always celebrated on the fourth Sunday of Lent. Is that true or false? Yes, it's Lent. We're very Anglican here. Go on, who'd like to go on Fern, true or false? Oh, it is, it's true. Count your Sundays of Lent. And actually, there was a little hint on your bulletin. It says fourth Sunday of Lent. But no, it's always celebrated on the fourth Sunday of Lent, which is why it changes date each year. So you might wonder, sometimes it's earlier in March, sometimes it's later. That's why, because it's always the fourth Sunday of Lent. Okay, well, here's another question. In the United States, where of course they do things differently, Mother's Day was first celebrated in 1907. True or false? Well, you have a go in a minute. I think the Bellamy's have got an answer there. True or false? Wait, it's actually true, apparently. 1907. Were you going to say true this time, Fern? Fern would have had that one. Never mind. And I think we might run out of my questions before too long. Okay, here's another one. In Japan, it is traditional to give your mum a pink carnation. So in Japan, it's traditional to give your mum a pink cup. You know the answer, Heather. You were in Denmark. Go on, you have another go, Fern. Your mother is right. It is false. It's traditional to give a red carnation in Japan. So do you want to give me two numbers, Fern?
2 and 8.
Okay. So under number 2, we've got a lamb and its mum. And number 8, we have got a cow and a calf. So not a pair there. Would have been pretty clever to have got a pair on the first go. So here we go. Let's put those back. Right. Next one. The simnel cake was traditionally made for Mothering Sunday rather than Easter. True or false? Well, let's give somebody else a go. Let's see who else is brave. Simnel cake made for Mothering Sunday. True or false? Dylan.
True.
You are right. It's true. It is true. It was the cake that the children or young people who'd gone away from home, maybe as apprentices or they'd gone away as servants in the big houses, they were allowed back to their mother church on Mothering Sunday and to their mothers, and they were often given a cake to take with them. And it was really important to have a fruity cake at this time of year, because when you're tied to just the crops grown in our own country, this is what we call the hungry gap now. It's when the winter crops are finished and we're waiting for the spring crops to all be ready. So really important. So that's what the simnel cake is. So Dylan, give me your first number.
Six.
Number 6. So your first number, oh, is the lamb and its mum.
2.
And number 2. Excellent. Well done. You've got the first pair. Well done, Dylan. Fab. Excellent. Okay. Next question. And we're on to Bible questions now. Moses' mother was called Miriam. True or false? Go on, Fern. You're so close. It is a family member, and she did act a bit like a mum to her. It was her sister. You're right. Well, I'll let you have that because you remembered it was her sister. Go on, give me a first number. Well, let's go for 8. 8's the cows. So where do you think the other cows might be? Three. Oh, that's a cat and a kitten. And just interesting, does anybody know what Moses' mother's name was?
No.
Mum? Yeah, probably. Or whatever that is in Hebrew. Anybody know? Close. Jochebed is Moses' mother's name. And interestingly, she was also his great aunt. Well, there we go. Interesting. You're all like that now. Look it up in Exodus. Okay, here's a slightly easier one. What was the name of Samuel's mum in the Bible? Oh, do you know, the Penmark lot were a lot more on the ball, weren't they, Heather and Rihanna? They were. Lydia, do you know? Hannah, you're right. It was Hannah. Well done. And I can remember that really easily because I've got a Hannah and her little boy Samuel, isn't it? So which number do you want to go for first?
3.
3 was the pussy cats. Where do you think the other cat and kitten is? 7, let's try. You're right, cat and kitten. Okay, now. It's a bit of a harder Bible one, this. Gomer's daughter was named Not Loved. What was the name of her dad? Ooh. All the cogs are turning now. Think of your minor prophets. What about them at home? Have they got an idea at home, Rihanna?
Nobody's said anything yet.
Is everybody as puzzled at home as they are in church? Somebody put their hand up and have a stab. It's one of the minor prophets. So you've got to go. Go on, Martin, you have a stab.
Nathan?
No, close. It wasn't. Anybody else want to have a go? It was Hosea. So, you can't have one for that. Right, what was the name of John the Baptist's mum? I think we've got some education to be doing in this group, my goodness me, this morning. Lydia. Elizabeth, brilliant. Woo! Which two? Give me your first one. A one. Horses. Nine. Oh, cows. Okay, here's a really easy one. What was the name of Jesus's mum? Wonder if we can get that. Go on, Dylan. Mary, hurrah. Right, give me a number. Eight. And nine. Oops. Brilliant. Okay. Right. Let me think. I've got to think of some more questions now. Well, this isn't a question about a mum, but it's a question about a lady in the Bible. Who was the lady who was chosen to be queen by King Xerxes? She was given a year of beauty treatments first. Go on, Karine. Esther. Esther, it was Esther. Do you want to give me your first number?
Five.
Number five. Horses. Where was the other horses? Number one. You're right, there we are. Woo. We got there in the end. I think maybe you'd all gone back to sleep after getting up this morning. We've got one left, and it is this one. It's a picture of a hen with her chicks, and that's it up there. The hen gathering up her chicks. So why do you think the hen's got her chicks underneath her wings? What's happening there? Go on, Dylan.
Like a house.
It's like a house. Okay. Poppy? To protect them. Yeah, the house protects us, doesn't it? It's like the roof of a house, it looks almost like, doesn't it? Yeah, she's got her wings out to protect. Were you going to say something as well, Lydia? What were you going to say? To keep them warm. It may well be that they're cold and she needs to protect them with her warmth. I saw another picture where it was raining really heavily and the hen's got her chicks underneath her wings to protect them from the rain. And I imagine that if there was some other danger nearby, then the chicks would go under their mother's wings for protection. Now, we think that about mothers, mother animals in particular. We think about how strong their protective instinct is. If a dog has got new puppies, we say, be careful around the dog with its puppies because she might nip you if she thinks her puppies are in danger. Where we used to live in Cardiff, there were urban seagulls that used to nest on the roofs. And in the springtime, sometimes you'd see the birds, once they'd hatched and they were starting to fledge to leave the nest, they'd be sort of stumbling around on the pavement. And the seagulls, the parent seagulls, if you got anywhere near their chicks, would dive bomb you. Like this, sometimes I'd have to leave the house with an umbrella up so that the seagulls didn't come and dive bomb me. But what they were doing was they were protecting their young. And that's what mothers do. We do it as human mothers, unless there's something that's stopping us, because some mothers can't do it because maybe they've got an addiction or a mental health problem. But most mums, their first instinct is to protect their children. I remember when Naomi was very small, we were in the IKEA car park and she just shot out and there was a car coming and I leapt like a goalie to save her from the car. Now, I'm not very athletic. That's not my natural thing, but I didn't think about it. The brain didn't engage. It was, you've got to save the child. And I spotted my Hannah doing something similar with baby Samuel. She was holding him and he was sick and she caught the sick in her hand so that it didn't go on the baby. Oh, that's really gross, isn't it? But that's what mums do, don't they? They've got a protective instinct to protect their children and to take care of them. And we hear it in sadder terms, don't we, when we think about poverty and the way that many families are really struggling. We hear stories of mums who feed their children but haven't got enough food for themselves. They give the food to their children instead. It's like that image. It's the mother protecting her young. So it's quite interesting to know that Jesus uses that image when he's talking about himself. We think about that maybe as a very female image, but Jesus uses it himself. It's Matthew chapter 23, verses 37 to 39. Now, if you've got your Bible there, whether you're in church or whether you're at home, it might be worth just turning it up, because we're going to look at what Jesus says, but we need to understand what he's saying by looking at what comes before it and what comes after it. So it's chapter 23, verses 37 to 39. And if you're using a church Bible, it's page 992. He says, "Jerusalem, Jerusalem, you who kill the prophets and stone those sent to you, how often I have longed to gather your children together, as a hen gathers her chicks under her wings, and you were not willing. Look, your house is left to you desolate. For I tell you, you will not see me again until you say, 'Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord.'" So Jesus is saying that he longs to gather up the people like a hen gathers the chicks. But what people was he talking to? Well, we need to look at what comes before it. And what comes before it is some real hard talking. Because Jesus is talking to the teachers of the law and the Pharisees, and he's giving them a real telling off. Because they had not been doing what they should have been doing. If you were here last week in church, or if you were watching online, you'd have heard Molly talking about when Jesus went into the temple and he turned over all the tables and he chased the sellers out. And you remember her saying that Jesus was so cross because they were stopping the Gentiles, the non-Jews, from coming into the temple and worshipping. Well, here Jesus gives them a telling off. Verse 13, "Woe to you, teachers of the law and Pharisees, you hypocrites! You shut the door of the kingdom of heaven in people's faces. You yourselves do not enter, nor will you let those enter who are trying to." So you say, not only were they stopping the Gentiles from coming to God, they were stopping the Jewish people as well. And they weren't even interested themselves. They're interested in the trappings of the religion. They're interested in the power they had. But they weren't interested in inviting people to worship God and to know him. And there was loads of other things they were doing wrong. You can read about it in the rest of that chapter. And he gives them a warning. And this warning is quite hard. But when you think about it, actually a good parent warns their children of danger. I might have said to mine when they were younger, "Don't go running into the road." Obviously it had no impact on Naomi, who just did her own thing anyway. But don't go running into the road because a car might knock you over. Or we might say, "Don't go playing near the railway lines. It's dangerous. The train might come and hurt you." We give warnings as parents to our children because we don't want our children hurt. And Jesus says this. It starts off with some quite stern language. Verse 33, "You snakes, you brood of vipers, how will you escape being condemned to hell? Therefore, I am sending you prophets and sages and teachers. Some of them you will kill and crucify. Others you will flog in your synagogues and pursue from town to town. And so upon you will come all the righteous blood that has been shed on earth, from the blood of the righteous Abel to the blood of Zechariah, son of Berechiah, whom you murdered between the temple and the altar. Truly I tell you, all this will come upon this generation." So he's quite stern, isn't he? But what they'd done was so bad. And he's saying, look, there's chances here. I'm sending people to tell you, people to teach you. Jesus himself had been with them for 3 years. This is right at the end of his ministry. Been with them for 3 years, teaching them about God, doing miracles and signs and wonders, healing people, doing everything that was prophesied in the Old Testament, and still they didn't listen. And he knew that they were plotting to kill him. And he also knew that they would kill the people who came after him. The vast majority of Jesus's apostles were killed because they loved Jesus. And so he's warning them. But he's not doing it in a kind of pointy finger. Yeah, this is what's going to happen to you. He's saying, no, I don't want this to happen to you. He longed to just gather them up and to protect them from what was coming their way. Like, oh, she's gone now, but like the hen who gathers her chicks up that we were looking at then. Jesus longed to just gather them up and keep them safe. But there's a crucial little phrase, and you were not willing. See, those chicks, can we have the picture back, Rhianna? Yeah, sorry, moved you on. But those chicks, they're there because they've taken shelter under their mum's wings. The mum will have fluffed herself out and the chicks will have come scurrying under. She may well have chased them a little bit to gather them, but they need to stay under by their own will, don't they? They could easily run out if they wanted to. She's not going to be able to stop them from doing it. They've gone there because they know they are safe. And that's what Jesus is offering to the people then, but also to any of us. He's saying, come to me, I'll protect you, I will keep you safe. And in fact, he did something really important to keep the people safe from that judgment that he told them about there in that chapter. Because that blood that had been shed that they were to take punishment for, Jesus took the punishment himself. He didn't just stretch out his wings to gather up people underneath. He stretched them out on the cross where he died. So that those people there and us today, when we disobey Jesus, didn't have to have that punishment. He took it himself. We just have to come to him. And that's a massive show of love, isn't it? Because we think about, you know, I leapt in a car park. Hannah caught some sick in her hand. You know, we do sacrificial things as parents for our children. To give your life for somebody else is the biggest sacrifice we can give. But to give your life for people who've rejected you, what sort of sacrifice is that? That's the greatest, isn't it? What a show of love that Jesus has given. And so when we love, we're modelling our love on his even greater love. That sacrificial love of a loving mother is patterned on what Jesus has done for us. And so when we're thinking about those who love us today and those who put themselves out for us and maybe sacrifice something for us, you also need to remember Jesus. Jesus who longs to gather us up. Jesus who's opened his arms on the cross for us. And we need to come to him. In him we find protection on the day of judgment, but we also find that love and that care now, day by day, each day, as we receive his love for ourselves. And so I'm just going to say a little prayer to thank God, and then we've got a little activity to do. So let's pray. Our loving Heavenly Father, we thank you for your great love for us. We thank you for Jesus's protective love. Thank you that he chose to sacrifice even his life so that his enemies could go free. Oh, what great love that is. Oh, help us as his friends, his children, to come to him each day, to receive his love, to know his protection and his care in our lives. And then as people who know that love, to be able to share that with others. For we ask in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Well, you might have seen at the front here, I've got a vase of rather beautiful flowers. Now, these were made by the people of Penmark. Well, people of all over the place who were worshipping in Penmark this morning. And you've also, if you're in church, you've got a little flower and a pipe cleaner as well. And so what I'd like you to do is on your flower, I want you to write a little thank you prayer. Now, so it's a prayer to God, So we're thanking God, but we're thanking God for the people who love us. So you can just put their names on there if you want to. You can put what you'd like to thank them for, or what they the way in which they show their love to you. And then I'm going to come round with the vase, because you can't come up to me, but I'll come round, put my mask on and come round with the vase, and you can join your flower with all of these lovely flowers. If you're at home, maybe you could either very quickly make a flower out of some paper, very simple, or just think about the people who show you love and care. That might be your mum, might be your grandma, might be somebody else who shows that love and that kindness, that sacrificial love, and then you can join in at home as well. So I'll give you a few minutes to do that, and then I shall come round with the vase so you can join them with it. Bendy one. Oh, look, you've made yours a fancy stem as well. Very pretty. Fab. Well, look at all those flowers now added to the flower prayers from earlier today. So I'm going to say a prayer of thank you. So loving Heavenly Father, we do give you thanks for all those who care for us, who love us. We thank you for all the people represented here by these flowers. Thank you for the love and kindness they show to us, and help us to be loving and kind too. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Well, you've given your flowers. Well, I've got some flowers here as well to give to the ladies in church. Men, don't feel left out, because on Father's Day there'll be something for you as well. But we're going to say a special thank you to the ladies today, because the ladies, whether they're mums or not, they do so much in the church. Men do too, but the ladies are usually the ones who are there doing the cleaning and the making the teas and all the behind the scenes thing, washing the linen and all of those types of jobs. We just need to give a big thank you for the jobs that we don't see. So I'm going to say a prayer of thank you for the flowers, and then I'm going to bring these round to the ladies as well. So loving Heavenly Father, we thank you for the beauty of spring. We thank you for these flowers, a token of your creativity and your beauty. I pray as these flowers go to the ladies in the congregation, we pray that each one would know that they are precious to you, valued so highly, that each one is the apple of your eye, whether they have a big upfront role, or whether they have a behind the scenes role, or whether they're not able to perform any role at all. that they are still so precious in your sight. And we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. So I'm going to bring these round, but put my mask back on again. Put those to your men. I'm just going to reach. There we are. One, two. So there we are, flowers distributed. Fantastic. Well, it's almost the end of our service, so I'm just going to do some notices before our final prayers today. Well, Wednesday was our annual vestry meeting, so big thank you to those of you who were a part of that. We've had some movers and shakers. We've had some who've left the PCC and some who have joined. So we said goodbye and big thank you for all their service to Clive and Ian and Pam and Avril from Penmark, and we welcomed onto the PCC Sarah from Penmark, and then John Bellamy, who's here today, and Ian, who's also here today, our newest member, already getting stuck in, fantastic, and Bill Micklejohn, who's come on after a big spell of absence, which is great to have him back on. And who have I missed? There's four. One, two, three. Who's the fourth? Oh, Sarah. No, I've got all four. Haven't missed anybody. Whew, what a relief. So big thanks to everybody who's stood for election. Now, church wardens are the same. So it's Liz and Graham with Jonathan and Si as the sub-wardens. Faith as our secretary. Conway as our treasurer. John Taylor as assistant treasurer. And Jackie Williams from Penmark as the assistant secretary. So those are your offices for the year. It's not even quite a year, because it'll be until the 1st of January when we do our larger merger with Dinas Powys, Wenvoe and Sully. So do pray for them. It is a big year this year. We've got the building project still all underway, and that has big decisions yet to be made. We've got work to do on Penmark as well, and all the business of the merger. So do pray for those as they take on this particular work in the church. Apart from that, just to say, Lent group is continuing on Mondays. So if you've not come yet, but you'd like to see what it's like, then ask me for the Zoom code. There's also going to be an evening service today. The Evangelical Fellowship of the Church in Wales, we're doing an evening service at 7. So that's happening as well. If you want to do that, then ask me for the Zoom code. I think there's any other notices? No? Well, let's finish with a blessing then. So the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be with each one of you and those you love this Mothering Sunday and always. Amen.